Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalamu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd. Continue reading in the chapter Sifati Salat al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the chapter with regards to the clarification of the description of the Salah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have been reading the first narration. The author, he mentioned rahimahullahu ta'ala, the narration of Abi Hurairah radiyallahu anhu, annahu qala kana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam idha kabbara fi salati sakata hunayhatan qabla an yaqra'a, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whenever he would make the takbir for salah, meaning saying Allahu Akbar, then he would be silent for a brief period of time. Before he would recite, meaning before he would begin reciting the Qur'an. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, he says, فَقُلْتُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, O Messenger of Allah, بِأَبِي أَنْتَ وَأُمِّي, I will ransom my mother and father for you. رَأَيْتُ سُكُوتَكَ بَيْنَ التَّكْبِيرِ وَالْقِرَاءَةِ, I saw your silence between the takbir and the recitation. This is the wording here in Al-Umdah, but what has come in Sahih Muslim, أَرَأَيْتَ سُكُوتَكَ بَيْنَ التَّكْبِيرِ وَالْقِرَاءَةِ, يعني أخبرني, يعني inform me of your silence between the takbir and the qira'ah. مَا تَقُول, what do you say? Again, this is a reminder that the sukut here and the silence here is not a silence from speaking, but rather it's a silence from speaking audible, or a silence, it's a silence from speaking out loud. This is what Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, he understood. مَا تَقُول, what do you say? And in this silence, in this period here between the takbir, which is made out loud, and the recitation likewise, which in some of the prayers is also out loud, what do you say in that brief period? At this time, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he informed him. قَالَ أَقُولُ, he said, I say, اللَّهُمَّ بَاعِدْ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ خَطَايَايَ كَمَا بَاعَدْتَ بَيْنَ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ, O Allah, distance me and separate me from my sins, just as you have distanced and separated from the east and the west. اللهم نقني من خطاياي كما ينقى الثوب الأبيض من الدنس, and purify me from my sins just as the white thobe is purified from filth and dirt. اللهم اغسلني من خطاياي بالثلج والماء والبرد, O Allah, cleanse me of my sins with snow and water and hail. With snow and water and hail. We have seen in our previous class some of the benefits with regards to this narration, alhamdulillah. And from that is that the prayer is began with a takbir. إِذَا كَبَّرَ فِي الصَّلَاةِ, whenever he would make the takbir. And this is something that is well known. But it's very important to remember that these words are legislated and they must be performed and pronounced properly. And an example of this has proceeded with regards to the takbir and other also legislative terms in the adhkar. And that was in the chapter of Al-Adhan. And we remind again here the same situation, and the people of knowledge, they mentioned this to clarify the importance of pronouncing these words properly. We have seen in our previous class that the word that must be pronounced is Allahu Akbar, or the statement that must be made is Allahu Akbar, and it would not suffice any other words of magnification or glory. Allahu Ahsan, O Allahu A'la, O Allahu A'zam, O Allahu Akram, and the likes like this. Although the meaning is correct, but it would not suffice, and it would not be correct here to enter the prayer. But rather the prayer, it has specific terms and words that must be pronounced property. So again, the people of knowledge, they mentioned that it must be said correctly, Allahu Akbar, meaning Allah is the greatest, and greater than everything. So one must not say Allahu Akbar. This has proceeded in the chapter of Adhan, and this means, is Allah the greatest? By extending the alif in the beginning, Allahu Akbar, A'udhu Billah, this is a question, and a shek, and a doubt. Or likewise, again, if one were to say Allahu Akbar, and put the elongation in the word Akbar. And we know that akbar is the plural of kabr, and the kabr is the drums, the tabul. So this has a foul statement, or this has a foul meaning, Allahu Akbar. So therefore, a believer, he will not put elongations wherever he likes or feels like, but rather he will He will pronounce the words properly, and this requires learning. Allahu Akbar, like this. Allahu Akbar. In this manner, the prayer, it begins. The prayer begins. It begins with takbir. It begins with takbir in this manner. Allahu Akbar. Not Allahu Akbar. Not Allahu Akbar. In the likes like this, but rather in the proper manner. The people of knowledge, they mentioned if they did not pronounce it properly, like if they said this opening statement in one of these manners that is not correct, then his prayer is not even correct. Then his prayer, it did not even begin, nor is it correct. So therefore, it's important to learn the proper way to pronounce these words, Allahu Akbar. This is how one begins the prayer. After this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he would be silent for a moment before he would begin reciting the Quran. And this is what Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, he is asking about. And this is what the author, he is clarifying likewise. That from the description of the prayer of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is that he would open the prayer with a supplication. That he would open the prayer sallallahu alayhi wasallam with a supplication. This supplication is known as du'a al-istiftah. Du'a al-istiftah. Du'a al-istiftah. The opening supplication. So after making the takbir and saying Allahu Akbar, one will not begin right away with the recitation of the Quran, but rather there is an introduction before that, and there is an opening supplication before that. And these have been narrated from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is from the description of his prayer. And it has come many different types of these supplications, or many different wordings, and the likes. But the one that the author has mentioned here from the narration of Abi Hurairah radiallahu anhu, this is the most authentic. This is the most authentic. And we see here that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he mentioned what he said. And he would say, Allahumma, Allahumma, ba'id bayni wa bayna khatayaya kama ba'adtal bayna al-mashriqi wal-maghrib. اللهم نقني من خطاياي كما ينقى الثوب الأبيض من الدنس اللهم اغسلني من خطاياي بالثلج والماء والبرد. O Allah, distance and separate between me and my sins, just as you have distanced and separated between the east and the west. O Allah, purify me from my sins, just as the white thobe is purified from dirt and filth. O Allah, cleanse me of my sins with snow and water and hail, with snow and water and hail. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he would open the prayer in this manner, saying Allahumma. Allahumma, the people of knowledge, they mentioned this means Ya Allah, Ya Allah, Allahumma. So the harfun nida is mahzuf, is deleted. The ya is deleted, and the meme takes its place and is placed on the end. This is seeking barakah by beginning strictly with the name of Allah. Allahumma. Allahumma. Oh Allah. And like this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he began the supplication. The supplication here, it consists of three different sentences. And he began sallallahu alayhi wasallam saying, Allahumma ba'id bayni wa bayna khatayaya kama ba'adta bayna al-mashriqi wal-maghrib. O Allah, separate me from my sins, or distance me from my sins, just as you have distanced and separated between the east and the west. And there is no doubt that this is a great distance, the distance between the east and the west. And this is something that the Arab, they used to mention, and they would use it as a parable or an example and the likes to have mubalagha with regards to the distance of something, and with regards to how or the length between something, between the distance of the between the east and the west, yani to mention in this manner like this, and to mention a mubalagha with regards to the affair of having a length, a great length between two issues, between two issues. And this is, as the people of knowledge, they have mentioned, what is intended here is the forgiveness of sins, and that Allah would forgive them, and that Allah would cover them and pardon them, and that one would not be held accountable for them. And likewise, no doubt, if the sins are forgiven, then they turn into good deeds. They are turned and multiplied into good deeds. And this is from the grace and the virtue and the fadl of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon his believing slave. That the one who sincerely repents to Allah, that Allah will exchange his bad deeds for good deeds. That Allah azza wa jalla will exchange his bad deeds for good deeds. And so what is intended here is that the previous sins will be forgiven. Allahumma ba'id bayni wa bayna khatayaya kama ba'adta bayna al-mashriq wal-maghrib. Oh Allah, distance me and separate me from my sins, just as you have separated from the in distance from the east and from the west. Meaning that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is seeking forgiveness for his past sins. That he is seeking forgiveness for his past sins. But likewise, also included in this supplication is also seeking success to stay away from the sins in the future. To stay away from the sins in the future. And he distanced me from sins. Distancing me from my past sins, not by forgiving them and covering them and pardoning me. And likewise, from the sins that could happen in the future, by giving me success to stay away from them. Separate me from your disobedience. And meaning give me success to be obedient to you. And give me success to be able to do the good deeds and to stay away from sins. And no doubt that, there's no doubt that the happiness and felicity and joy of a person truly is found whenever it is easy for him to do good deeds. Or whenever doing good deeds are facilitated for him and Allah has given him success. At this time, a believer, he will find happiness and contentness in his heart. And he will find peace and tranquility by the permission of Allah whenever it becomes easy for him to obey Allah and to do the good deeds and to stay away from sins. So like this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he would begin his prayer calling on Allah. Calling on Allah to purify him and to distance him from his sins and to forgive him for his sins and to grant him success. To stay away from the sins in the future. So this is the meaning here of the first sentence. But likewise, after this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam continued in the supplication, Allahumma naqini min khatayaya kama yunqa thawb al-abyad min ad-danas. Oh Allah, purify me from my sins, just as the white thawb is purified from dirt and from filth. Oh Allah, purify me from my sins, just as the white thawb is purified from the dirt. Likewise, we see the beautiful supplication here, the supplication for at-tanqiyah, purification, to purify something. And it's known that purification, yani of the outward things and the tangible things, this is meaning to purify something from dirt or from filth. That purification and tanqiyah, naqini. It's from the verb naqqa, yunaqqi. Naqqi tanqiyatan. Tanqiyatan. Tanqiyah, it only comes whenever there is filth there, or something that is dirty there, or an impurity is there. Whenever there is denis, or whenever there is wasikh, and the like this, something that is dirty or filthy, then one will purify that. One will purify that by removing that filth and by removing that dirt. But here, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he wants to be purified. He's asking to be purified from sins. And no doubt the sins are a type of filth and a type of impurity that comes to the heart and comes to the soul. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in this example, he mentioned he asked to have his sins purified in the same manner that the white thawb is purified from dirt or from filth. And the mentioning of the white garment here is very, very beneficial with regards to this understanding. And that is because the white garment, any filth that comes to it can be seen and can be known and is clearly apparent. Meaning that the white garment, it is affected by the smallest particles or by the smallest amount of dirt, and it becomes very apparent and it's very clear to see. And like this, the sins also, they have an effect on the heart. The heart is like this white garment, and it becomes impure very easy. It can be corrupted and become dirty, and it can be harmed and very easily. Just like the white thawb, it can become filthy very quickly. Very quickly, as opposed to a gray thawb, or a blue thawb, or a darker colored thawb. that, or a brown thobe, for example, a brown garment, maybe some dirt or and the likes will get on the thobe and one will not even be able to see it. But as for the white thobe, meaning the smallest speck of dirt or of mud, it will show on there and it will be apparent. And like this, likewise, the heart. The heart is similar in this manner. And the heart, it must be kept clean and it must be purified. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is requesting this and he is supplicating for this from Allah, that his heart will be purified from sins and from sins, just as the white thobe is purified from filth and from dirt, from filth and from dirt. So just like the white thobe, it can become dirty, and dirt shows on it very easily, and it is apparent on the white thobe very easily. Likewise, the heart, it can become corrupted, and it can become filthy, and that can happen very easily, even to the extent that the heart can become black. And even like this, the people of knowledge, they make a beautiful example of the dangers of sins. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's mentioning here, ba'id bayni wa bayna khatayaya, naqqini min khatayaya, ighsilni min khatayaya. Al-khataya is the plural of khati'a. Al-khati'a, it means a sin, an action of disobedience. Ma'asiyah. Khati'atun, it means ma'asiyah. And the ma'asiyah, disobedience, it means to leave an obligation and to not fulfill that duty properly, or to perform or to fall into and to commit a prohibition. And this is called khati'ah or ma'asiyah. So the people of knowledge, they mention likewise that the sins are like the one who is wearing a white thobe. And the example of the sins on the heart is like, and the soul is like the one who's wearing a white thobe. In the beginning, his white thobe is beautiful and it's bright and it's clean and pure. But as he's moving throughout the day, if he's not careful, then he can get his thobe dirty. And they make example of the one who's walking through the mud. In the beginning, while he's walking, when he leaves his home, for example, if he has a white thobe on, he'll be cautious as he's walking through the mud. And he's not going to just step here and there, but rather he will watch where he's stepping so that he does not get any mud and the likes on his white thobe. So as he's moving along and his thobe, he's being cautious as he's walking, and then something happens and a spot gets on his thobe. And then he's, oh, subhanallah. I gotta be more careful. I don't want to get my thobe dirty. In this manner. And then if he keeps continuing, if he's not careful, another spot. But as long as there's just a few spots on his thobe, he continues to be cautious. But after some time, if, for example, a big splash comes onto the thobe, at this time he's not going to have any concern anymore. The thobe is going to be filthy, and he's not going to have concern for keeping his thobe clean. Like this, the heart. The first time, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if a person commits a sin, nukita ala qalbihi nuktatun sawda, that a black spot would be placed on the heart in the time of sin. And if a person, he leaves the sin and repents, suqira qalbuhu, that his heart will be purified and cleansed. But if not, then that black spot will continue to grow, another one and another one. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned, until the extent that those black spots, meaning those sins, can cover his heart and can corrupt his heart entirely. And this is the meaning of the statement of Allah azza wa jal, bal rana ala qulubihi ma kanu yaksibun, but rather their hearts are covered with ran, meaning their hearts are covered in darkness and blackness because of the sins that they used to do, because of that which they used to earn from the foul and evil deeds. So likewise, the heart, just like the white thobe, it can become filthy and it can become dirty. But the important point here, likewise, to know and to remember that a believer, he will not despair or give up hope, but rather, just like that white thobe as well gets dirty, it can become clean and purified. And like that, the heart, likewise, it can become clean and purified. And this is by seeking forgiveness from Allah with sincere faith, with sincere repentance, with tawheed, and with remorse and with regret, and the likes like this, and with determination and strong resolve, and by leaving the sins for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jalla. In this manner, the heart can become clean again. So here in the statement of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allahumma naqqini min khatayaya kama yunqqa thawb al-abyad min ad-danas, O Allah, purify me from my sins just as the white thawb is purified from the filth. This is a beautiful explanation or a beautiful example and parable for a believer to remember and to show concern for his heart and to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to purify his heart. And this is something that a believer he'll be concerned about. He'll be concerned about his heart and he'll be concerned about his soul because he's going to be held accountable. He's going to be held accountable. So therefore, from the opening supplication of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to seek forgiveness for sin, from sins in this manner. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he closed the supplication with the third sentence, Allahumma ghsilni min khatayaya. Allahumma ghsilni min khatayaya bil ma'i wal thalji wal barad. Oh Allah, cleanse me of my sins with water and with snow and with hail. And the wordings have come differently like this. Some of them bilma'i wa thalji wal barad, and other wordings bithalji wal ma'i wal barad. They're all authentic on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And with the arrangement of these three words, Allahumma ghsilni min khatayaya bilma'i wa thalji wal barad. Oh Allah, cleanse me of my sins with water and with snow and with hail. With water and with the snow and with hail. We see here that it's very clear that water is the greatest means of purification. You need to purify something, one will use water. To purify something, one will use water. But normally when someone is going to purify something like a garment or the likes, they will purify that with hot water. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam here, he didn't mention hot water. He didn't mention hot water. But rather, he mentioned the water, and then he mentioned two affairs that are cold, and that is snow and hail. Snow and hail. The hail is the ice that comes from the sky, and the raindrops that become frozen and that come from the sky. And likewise, the thalaj and the snow is similar. These things are well known. But this is what he asked to be purified with. And it's mentioned that because whenever something is washed with warm water or with hot water, it loosens it up. It loosens it up. But whenever something is washed with cold water, it makes it firm. It makes it firm. And also, it's very suitable here to mention cold water with regards to sins. Because sins, they have along with them harara and a type of heatness. And likewise, the sins, they lead to the hellfire, which is a blazing fire. So therefore, it's very suitable to mention for the sins to be removed in this manner with cold water. With water and then with hail and snow. And meaning that the water is for purification and the hail and the snow. And the hail and the snow is in order to make that water cold. And to put out the heat from the sin and the likes like this. And to put out the heat from the sin. And likewise, the benefit the people of knowledge mentioned from the cold water is that it cleanses, in the mentioning of cold, in order to cleanse, but also to make something tight and firm. So therefore, it's as if he's saying, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to purify him from his sins and to make, with this manner, with this cold water, in order to make the heart clean and pure from sins, and likewise to make it firm and strong upon the obedience of Allah Azza wa Jal. To make it firm and strong upon the obedience of Allah Azza wa Jal. So these are some of the benefits that the people of knowledge, they mentioned with regards to the explanation of this beautiful opening supplication, the supplication known as Dua al-Istiftah. And by pondering over the likes of this supplication and the other adhkar and statements that are made in the prayer and the recitation of the Qur'an specifically, the recitation of the Qur'an specifically, but likewise the other statements that are made in the salah, likewise, this is from the greatest means to have khushu' and humbleness and humility. That one will ponder over this. That one, whenever he steps into the prayer, he says, Allahu Akbar. Allah, he is the greatest. That means that at this time, a believer should leave everything behind. The one who says Allahu Akbar, Allah is the greatest, and he's thinking about the dunya, but his heart is thinking about the dunya. At this time, yani his heart and his tongue are not in accordance. So therefore, a believer, he should strive while he is in prayer to have his heart and his tongue in accordance. That he's saying Allahu Akbar and his heart is magnifying Allah by remembering Him and hoping in Him and trusting Him and relying upon Him and fearing Him and knowing His greatness, Subhanahu wa ta'ala, and glorifying Him, and then likewise remembering one's own sins. In this manner, the Prophet, he would open his prayer, Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then he would make the supplication. O Allah, distance me, separate me from my sins. The distance, or the manner that you have separated in distance from the east and the west. A believer, he will remember that he has shortcomings and he has faults and he has sins. First and foremost, that he has done with regards to the rights of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And likewise, he has sins and also actions of transgression against his own soul and against his family and against the people and the likes like this. And these sins, they can have a terrible effect on a believer. Therefore, one will seek forgiveness for them, and he will seek pardon for them, and he will ask to be purified from them in this manner, and he will hope that his heart will be strong and firm upon Allah's obedience. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would begin the prayer in this manner, with fear and with hope and with love and magnification and glory. Even before sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he began reciting the words of Allah, he would begin in this manner magnifying Allah and seeking forgiveness for his sins and pardon and purification of his soul and his heart, cleansing of his heart, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is the manner that a believer, he will worship Allah, and he will open in this manner. He will open the prayer in this manner. There are other supplications as well, and I mentioned it, and whichever one a believer he brings is good, alhamdulillah. But likewise, it has proceeded that it's preferred for a believer to learn more than one of them, and to change from time to time, and use one this time, and another one the next time. And one of the most well-known opening supplications is in the narration of Umar. And although it is not muttafaqun alayhi, but it is one that is well known, and it is one that Imam Ahmad, he has preferred, rahimahullah ta'ala, and it is from the shortest of those opening supplications. And because of this, inshallah, in our next class, we will discuss this supplication, and we will add it to our classes here for the benefit, inshallah, hoping to benefit the brothers and sisters, those who have memorized this supplication. The opening supplication mentioned in the hadith of Umar, and that is the statement, Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdik wa tabaraka ismuka wa ta'ala jadduka wa la ilaha ghayruka. And inshallah, in the class to come, we will discuss this particular opening supplication. Has come and from the hadith of Umar in Sunan Abi Dawood, and other than that, and the likes like this, and hoping to benefit the brothers and sisters in explaining this narration in a bit of brief detail, so that they can benefit in their prayer and in their salah by the permission of Allah, by pondering and knowing the words of the prayer and that which they are saying. هذا وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.